Make sure to bring a pencil and some paper
yes.
to write on. You want to remember the team your opponent is using, and you want to make some notes, like which Pokemon they need, which item does he have on Pokemon X or Pokemon ABC, and yeah, it's really hard, especially in a best of three. You want to remember.
You have to remember all that crucial information that you get. Something we talked about yesterday was the fact that in a best of three, game one, even if you lose it, you get so much crucial information. You can get things like which Pokemon are faster than others, what items they might be running, and then even you go into game two, even if you go into it with a loss, you go into it with that advantage and that extra information that you can use. So yes, do bring a notebook, bring a pen and paper. During a VGC match, you are allowed to take notes as you go through the game, but you must always go into the next game with a completely beautiful, clean sheet of paper to make your notes for the next game.
Yeah, we have seen Ashton Cox like rolling all over Lyos in the first match, and then Lyos like really made a game plan out of the information he got from Ashton, and then he turned it around and won game two and three and advanced to the next round. And look at the players. Arash is always kind of calm player, so is Alejandro, and no doubt these are top tier players
we got
in Europe, and I'm really excited how this turns out.
This is some of the cream of the European crop I think we have on stream today.
Absolutely.
And we've had just like incredible match after incredible match. This has just been, we're being spoiled this weekend. This is wonderful.
This is the Pokemon International Championship, and that's why I really love this tournament. You get so many highlight matches for you guys out there and for us to watch and to commentate on. And I think the players are getting ready, and I'm really looking forward to the teams they are bringing.
Yeah. Oh, we've got the microphone down. They're going into live competition mode. They're just not quite ready to see the teams just yet. But I'm excited that we get to showcase a little more talent. And I think we'll just be bringing round after round of Masterclass.
Yeah. We have seen so many familiar names making it to day two. And I already heard that the game might start in a few seconds. And whoa. I'm excited.
You ready? Ready to go into the first game of today?
I am ready.
Cool. So we have the teams for you. We have got on Arash's side, we've got Feramosa.
Whoa.
That's something that's fun to see. We've got Tapu Lele, Araquanid, Alolan Ninetales, Incineroar, and Orangaroo.
And on PokéAlex's side, we got Araquanid, we got Porygon2, Tapu Koko, Kartana, Salamence, and Muk. Again, another Muk.
Oh, here we go. So, we've got some very unusual Pokémon here. There's a few that we haven't actually seen on stream yet.
We haven't seen, like, Feramosa, Tapu Lele on stream yet, but this is a pretty common combination. Feramosa is known for dishing out a huge amount of damage and being very, very fast, and Tapu Lele saves it from getting knocked out by priority moves, though. So this is a pretty common combination, but Incineroar, we haven't seen that often. It got that...
Not seen at all, have we?
No, and it's not of a common Pokémon yet. Though it got the Fake Out option, it got a pretty unique typing in Dark and Fire, and here we see the opening.
Did I see Love Ball Alolan Ninetales there? Gosh, that's pretty. And that might have been a Love Ball Muk as well. So here we have the leads. We have Alolan Ninetales and Araquanid on Arash's side. Ninetales, a snow warning going off and setting up the hail. Alejandro leads with his own Araquanid partnered next to Alolan Muk.
And this is a pretty good lead for Alejandro. Right there, he got that Muk with poison moves. Well...
So Muk can run a couple of different abilities. You never know. We might have Poison Touch, but I think it's more likely that we have the Power of Alchemy ability on these Muks.
Yeah.
On this Muk. Araquanid has the Water Bubble ability, which has that sneaky, secretive extra effect of doubling the power of its water type moves. And as we have seen, Ninetales has Snow Warning. Ninetales coming in with the Protect here, as is Arash's own Araquanid. Now, Arash's Araquanid's... If I was going to talk about speed ties there, but Alejandro's has not protected. Muk trying to get in the poison jab there, and Araquanid going for the liquidation, double targeting the Ninetales.
Pretty clever to take that Ninetale out as soon as possible. But do not forget that a Glutening on Muk might be possible as well for some special berries to heal back up a huge amount of health. And still the board position didn't change at all. Arash now has to switch out his Ninetales, otherwise it gets knocked out. He gets some pretty neat. Well, the only safe switching he could do is Incineroar, which doesn't get taken out. But Araquanid could just use a Water type move in that slot and.
Yeah, definitely. It would be risky. Incineroar doesn't want to be taking one of those incredibly bulky, powerful water moves from Araquanid, but we have the Aurora Veil going up. Aurora Veil is a new move that can only be used in Hail, but it's effectively light screen and Reflect all in one move.
Yeah.
Here we have the Poison Jab from Muk going into the Ninetales slot. Ninetales just surviving in there. Oh, but it does get the poison. So Ninetales is probably not going to be around for too much longer. Here we have a lovely flowing water type Z move here on Araquanid. We're going to be seeing the Hydro Vortex.
Yeah.
But which one is it going to be targeting into?
I guess the Ninetales. Alejandro wanted to go for a lead as soon as. Sorry, guys.
It was Arash's own Araquanid that was using it. Going into that Muk and dealing.
Whoa!
Incredible damage, and that is Muk taken down. That's impressive. Muk, especially alone Muk, is incredibly bulky.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a huge knockout. Now Arash got Aurora Veil up and just trades Pokemon.
I think that was an okay trade. He's got Hail up.
Absolutely.
He's managed to get his Aurora Veil up. His team is now got that extra little bit of bulk just to help him survive some of the very strong attacks that could be coming in from Alejandro's side.
That waterfall did so much damage.
Oh my goodness! Yes, but
liquidation probably. But
here come the Alolan Guardians.
In comes Tapu Koko and. Tapu Koko's Electric Surge activates first, and then we see Tapu Lili's Psychic Surge. Now we know that Tapu Koko is faster, and Tapu Lili doesn't wear a Choice Scarf, which is a common item. And Tapu Lili is now able to dish out a huge amount of damage. Arash already got the Aurora Veil up, so his Araquanid probably doesn't go down to a Thunderbolt coming from Tapu Koko, not boosted by Electric Terran. And this is. Arash is doing really good. He's preparing the board to slowly take out some Pokemon from Alejandro.
And I think Alejandro realized this, going on the defensive a little bit, keeping his Tapu Koko protected. Tapu Lili using Psychic, and it was right to protect the Tapu Koko because he's managed to avoid that. Here we have Scald from Araquanid into the opposing Araquanid, maybe trying to get a burn off there?
Yeah, probably he's fishing for some burn. I've never seen a Scald on Araquanid before. Good choice there.
But here we have Alejandro's own Z move. Also on the Araquanid, we're going to be seeing another Hydro Vortex. And we'll just have to see who it's going to go into. Who are we targeting? Is the Tapu Lele.
And this is going to be really crucial. And.
Oh! It looks like that Aurora Veil important there, but it's not going to matter because the Hail is going to deal that last little bit of chip damage and take down Tapu Lele.
What a huge amount of damage. That's
almost a shame.
Hydro Vortex.
Arash's own Hail working against him there.
Yeah, absolutely. So Arash got a pretty good situation, but Alejandro did a really good read. He protected the Tapu Koko, and I guess Arash just thought that Alejandro thinks Arash is going to attack the Araquanid, and mind games coming off, and people usually don't see how much of a mind game really happens on this battlefield. And now Pheromosa comes in, and Pheromosa is just such an aggressive Pokemon. But as we have seen, Arash doesn't have does have. The rip. Help me out.
So Pheromosa is the fastest thing on the field. It's the fastest thing in the format. It's probably one of the only things that could be outspeeding Tapu Koko right now.
Yeah, but Guys, I'm back.
There we go, Seppi's back.
Nightshade gets no warning, so it's not that likely that Faramuzzi got a focus sesh. And he's going for a poison jab, taking out the Tapu Koko in one hit and boosting the highest static guard. And it is...
it's speed. No surprises there. Oh, but that is a life orb, Faramuzzi. Obviously, Liquidation going into the Faramuzzi spot, very powerful, and Faramuzzi, unfortunately, as much as it is very fast and very powerful, it is very, very frail. So it's done its work in taking out the Tapu Koko, but it's also been sacrificed, and now Arash's Araquanid is the last thing left on his side of the field.
And still, this is like a huge matchup. I didn't expect to see two Araquanids, and then we got to see Scald from Arash's side, and I think this is a good decision. And now Alejandro sends in my favorite Ultra Beast, Kartana, doing a really good amount of damage to Arachnid. And Kartana is pretty bulky on the defensive, on the physical side, so Arachnid is not going to.
But as we have seen, this is an Araquanid full of surprises. We saw it use Scald earlier, and benefiting off that hail, it is using Blizzard. This means that Kartana is not going to be able to survive as long as it would probably like to, but it is still pretty fast. It's probably going to be able to deal out its own damage. And the hail has now stopped, which means Blizzard is not going to be flawless accuracy anymore, and that is a pity for Arash.
Blizzard Araquanid. I've never seen it. Never ever. Well, the format is new, but this is a new set as well. Pretty huge. And the Leaf Blade almost taking it out. Are we going to see a freeze, which would help?
I think it would have to be a freeze at this point. We don't get the freeze. And Alejandro's own Araquanid is going to use Leech Life to take game one.
Whoa, what crazy teams from both sides. I really, really love that. I didn't expect Alex to bring Muk and Araquanid to this tournament. Neither did I expect Arash to bring Faramuzzi and special Araquanid.
Special Araquanid.
That is amazing. That is amazing. The Blizzard probably would have taken out that Kartana. And if he got the freeze, this could have turned the tables around.
Can't rely on that sort of thing. I think he would have had to get the freeze on both of the opposing Pokemon at that point. And That's the sort of luck that you've really got to have your fingers crossed for. But it's one of those interesting things. So we have seen all sorts of really interesting metagame calls. We've seen Magnezone yesterday, there with its magnet pull to deal with Celesteela. We've seen things like Toxic Arcanine floating around. We've had the Toxic on Porygon 2 as well. People making these calls for these potentially more stalling, more bulky, longer games. And maybe Special Araquanid is another of these early metagame calls.
Absolutely, absolutely. But Arash didn't build a stally team.
No.
I didn't expect Araquanid to like really half Blizzard, half that Skull. And he's really going pretty offensive with the Faramuzzi Tapu Lele core, which is pretty well known. Then he got this Araquanid Ninetales core, probably covering opposing Trick Rooms as well, because Araquanid is naturally pretty slow. Then he got his Oranguru. We haven't seen doing Oranguru stuff on stream yet. It's one of my favorite Pokemon, being able to set up Trick Room and instruct really strong moves. And Incineroar we haven't seen on stream yet. And then we got Alex's team with another Araquanid. We got Muk, as we have seen from Wolf yesterday, a pretty neat choice, and he explained us why he chose Muk. He got Porygon 2 as well, then Kartana and Salamence. Well, Salamence is a thing Alex likes a lot. He really often brings Salamence to tournaments, and it oftentimes pays out. And I'm really curious if Arash is going to go for the hail mode again, or if he's just trying to pick up some knockouts as fast as possible. As we have seen, Faramuzzi is able to learn high jump kick. Mm-hmm. Maybe being able to take up Porygon 2 in one hit, because we have seen the life orb. And there we see the teams coming up.
We don't seem to have sound this time round, so you guys are going to have to listen to us a little bit more. There we go. There's a little bit of sound. There we go. We get some sound effects. So yes, here we go. We have got Feromosa and Ninetales, slightly more aggressive lead from Arash's side this time round, and we have Muk and Araquanid once again on Alejandro's side.
Again, this is a pretty aggressive lead from Arash. Feromosa even learns Blizzard as well, so there may be some Blizzard spam thing from Arash's side, but Araquanid resists Blizzard obviously, and Muk is pretty sturdy and could take out one Pokemon in return if he stands the Blizzard spam.
So obviously we're meant to be commenting on these players' skill, but I also want to comment on their fashion choices. Alejandro, he's got the basic trainer there. He's not done any customization. I really think he could have put in more of an effort into his trainer's appearance for this tournament. Arash, he's the stylish one. He's come in with a stylish pose. He's got his sunglasses on. That's effort. I appreciate that. Important protect there from Feromosa. Yeah. More back onto important things. Does take a little bit of hail damage, but similar to last game, we see quite a slow, just a board building first turn. Both players just sort of scout each other out a little bit.
Yeah, Arash is playing it pretty safe. He just wants to see what is Alejandro going to target. And then the mind games begin. Then Alejandro has to choose whether he targets again the same Pokemon or not. And now Arash cannot protect anymore. He has to go offensive. And he better wants to take out one Pokemon to not getting knocked out both.
Well, it's almost certain that Feromosa is going to be able to get off a powerful attack here. As we say, she is the most fast thing in the format with 151 base speed, which is 21 points above the next one down, Tapu Koko and Crobat and friends. So we see Muk going for Protect, Feromosa using Hyped Jump Kick. Oh, sadly it was the Muk that protected and Feromosa takes that recoil damage.
This was absolutely, I for myself didn't expect that Protect from Muk, neither did Arash. He was not expecting it, and whoa, that was a really huge play. Alejandro takes out the Feromosa. This is really huge.
And that is such a big deal because Feromosa is such a presence and such an offensive threat when it's on the field. To have taken it down so neatly with just a tiny bit of hail chip damage, that's huge for Alejandro. It does mean that Arash has got the Aurora Veil up again. But we didn't see that being so critical in the previous game. We'll have to see if it is more important this time round. We've got Araquanid coming out in place of Feromosa, this special Araquanid. We might see it firing off some blizzards.
I've never seen a blizzard Araquanid before. This is like really a odd and creative choice from Arash. But he doesn't look that happy with his Feromosa being taken out. Excellent read from Alejandro, protecting the Muk, not taking any damage at all, besides some chip hail damage. And now his Araquanid is also pretty dangerous for the Ninetales. Muk and Araquanid may.
Oh, we see Wyvern from Araquanid here. That is a wonderful tech move to have on it, potentially trying to get past these blizzards that could be coming in. But we see Freeze Dry from Ninetales. That's going to be super effective on the Araquanid. Not quite doing a fair amount of damage, but not a huge amount. Muk, however, is going to do great things with its Poison Jab, taking Ninetales down to the red HP and getting that poison off again. That's probably not going to take Ninetales down this turn, but it's almost certainly going to reduce Ninetales' longevity greatly. Here we see the Hydro Vortex coming in for a rush. We know now that it's a special Hydro Vortex. Yeah. It depends on the physicality of the base move that is used from. So Hydro Vortex can be physical or special, but this will probably be Scald Hydro Vortex into the Muk slots.
Let's have a look.
Once again, Muk falling to a Hydro Vortex from the Araquanid.
Those water sap moves from Araquanid are so insanely strong.
Water Bubble is a scary ability.
Absolutely. First, you may overread that ability, but once you try out your Araquanid on yourself, you see how powerful those water type attacks are. And a really good read from Arash, not going for any Blizzard at all. He plays Araquanid himself.
Yeah, that was so good.
And he knows that there is the potential from White Guard coming, and this was a good read from Arash.
But here we have Tapu Koko has now switched into the field. Tapu Koko now being the fastest thing on the field. We'll have to see if it can deal out some of the damage that it didn't really get to deal out last time.
Yeah, this is a pretty good situation for Alejandro now. He can easily take out Arash's Pokemon, Arachnid moved after Muk. So it's really, really slow, and it gets its attack off last. And
yeah, that's a good shout from him. He's gone for the Dazzling Gleam, not fearing the opposing Wide Guard from Arash's own Naraquinid, and it takes down Ninetales. Ninetales would have gone down at the end of the turn anyway, but this means it's not able to get off its own powerful special attack. We have Leech Life from Alejandro's Araquanid, healing back a little bit of its own health. And
we see Surf!
What is this? This is Surf Araquanid, ladies and gentlemen. And that has done quite pleasant damage. It's not quite enough to take out the Tapu Koko. It's got a couple of turns of Hail Chip at the very least there now. But that's interesting. Interesting Absolutely. That Arash didn't fear the Wide Guard this time.
He maybe had to go for Surf to take out both Pokemon. Oh, and there he comes.
Here comes a Rangaroo.
This is going to be interesting. If Arash gets up the Trick Room, and we have seen Arachnid move last, so it's naturally slower than Alejandro's Arachnid. So Arash is trying to get up the Trick Room and to fire off some attacks. He can easily take out Tapu Koko, but he has to think about how to take it out.
This is the thing, because he could go, if he manages to get Trick Room off and get the Surf off with Arachnid, we haven't seen if it has Protect yet, I don't think. He could go for the Surf, and that would be, he'd be able to take out both of them potentially, but he would have to be very careful of that Wide Guard from Alejandro's Araquanid. So he might be better off single targeting, but then if he does that, then whichever Pokemon survives gets to use an attack on him. It's all big mind games. But we see Wide Guard going up from Alejandro's Araquanid.
Whoa!
And Taunt from Tapu Koko. And that is a sad Arangaroo.
That is a absolutely sad Arangaroo, and Arash didn't expect that taunt at all. This would have changed the whole thing. Arash would have been freely to fire off attacks, because when Arachnid Wide Guards, it doesn't do any damage. So Arangaroo could have taken out Tapu Koko, and this would have changed, but Arash's taunt on Tapu Koko is a really huge tag.
Yeah, that was such a good turn by Alex, because he just completely nullified what both Pokemon were about to do on the opposing side of the field. And now he knows that Arangaroo not really known for being an attacking Pokemon. I think Alex probably has this at this point. Arangaroo does still have full health, which is very good for him. Okay, Arash has gone for the handshake, and Alex has taken it.
Arash forfeited, and Alejandro wins our first Swiss game of Day 2 Pokemon International Championships.
Wowee. This tournament is just so full of surprises.
Absolutely. This is the tournament to be in. Whoa. We have seen so many crazy stuff, Kate. Like, really crazy stuff. Blizzard, Surf, Arachnid. This is like, whoa.
My life.
And I totally got wrong information about PokéAlex team. So no rain, no Goodra at all. Instead, he brought Arachnid himself with a White Guard. He got Porygon 2, Tapu Koko, Cortana, Salamence, and Muk. And again, we have seen Muk dealing huge amount of damage to the fairy types running around.
Yeah, and I think Poison Jab is a really important move this time around. We've seen it on Muk, we see it on Garchomp, we've seen Sludge Bombs coming out from Gengar and Goodra. It's interesting seeing Poison being one of the prominent attacking types in a format.
People fear Muk for being known as, how did Nano say, compromise, but he meant minimize strategy, blah, 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 never mind. Muk was known for using Minimize, and people have been aware of that. And then we see two top tier players bringing just an offensive Muk and doing so well with it. I didn't expect that to happen, to be honest.
No, yeah, I was almost expecting to see one of the slightly more gimmicky teams with the Power of Alchemy, the Psycup Muk teams that we've seen running around. But no, they brought their Muk. It was there to take out the Ninetales. Alex's Muk did its job both games. The Ninetales went down doing no more than the Aurora Veil, which didn't actually prove to be that critical in either game. And yeah, I think they.
Yeah,
good.
Mac is one of the few viable knockoff users, as Wolfie stated out yesterday. He was searching for a really viable knockoff user, and then he came up with Mac. Nice typing, poison jab, knockoff. That's probably all you need on the Mac. And I'm really impressed by Alex's team, but so am I from Arish's team. He got. It's such an offensive team with so many out options. The super fast Tapulele Feromosa mode, and then we got the super slow Oranguru Arankanid mode with Surf.
Surf. And Incineroar, which is quite slow. It's one of these. This format has a lot of middling speed Pokemon, yeah, which can run either way. So I think Incineroar probably playing more into the Trick Room side of things, but still able to function outside of Trick Room.
Absolutely, especially with a Fake Out option. We do not have that many Fake Out users, and Incineroar has this nice typing of being able to one hit KO maybe those Celesteelas to really threaten those Marowaks, for example. And I really love that typing, and I really hope Arash is doing well this day to maybe have him on stream later on, because I really love this awesome and special team.
We'll have to follow his progress and see how he and some of our other known players do throughout the day. So that was our first game. Do you think that's do you think that's it? Do you think that's our highlight of the day done, or do you reckon we've got some even better matches coming up?
Team wise, I think we have seen like really cool choices, absolutely. But as we have seen yesterday, the deeper you get into the tournament, the more similar teams get, and there are usually one or two like really odd ones out, but usually you see pretty similar teams, and
yeah,
and I'm really interested in if one of those two teams makes a really deep run this time and be the odd one out from the other ones. And guys, we introduced you to Ryan.
So because the hail is going to deal that last little bit of chip damage and take down Tapu Lele.
What a huge amount of damage. That
was almost
Hydro Vortex.
Arash's own hail working against him there.
Yeah, absolutely. So Arash got a pretty good situation, but Alejandro did a really good read. He protected the Tapu Koko, and I guess Arash just thought that Alejandro thinks Arash is going to attack the Arachnid, and mind games coming off, and people usually don't see how much of a mind game really happens on this battlefield. And now Feromosa comes in, and Feromosa is just such an aggressive Pokemon, but as we have seen, Arash doesn't have does have the help me out.
So Feromosa is the fastest thing on the field. It's the fastest thing in the format. It's probably one of the only things that could be outspeeding Tapu Koko right now.
Yeah, but guys, I'm back.
There we go. Steppy's back.
Ninetales gets no warning, so it's not that likely that Feromosa got a focus sesh, and is going for a poison jab, taking out the Tapu Koko in one hit, and boosting the highest static guard, and it is...
it's
speed.
No surprises there. Oh, but that is a Life Orb Feromosa.
And
we see Liquidation going into the Feromosa spot, very powerful, and Feromosa, unfortunately, as much as it is very fast and very powerful, it is very, very frail. So it's done its work in taking out the Tapu Koko, but it's also been sacrificed, and now Arash's Araquanid is the last thing left on his side of the field.
And still... oh, this is like a huge matchup. I didn't expect to see two Araquanids, and then we got to see Scald from Arish's side, and I think this is a good decision. And now Alejandro sends in my favorite Ultra Beast, Kartana, doing a really good amount of damage to Araquanid, and Kartana is pretty bulky on the defensive, on the physical side. So Araquanid is not going to...
But as we have seen, this is an Araquanid full of surprises. We saw it use Scald earlier, and benefiting off that hail, it is using Blizzard. This means that Kartana is not going to be able to survive as long as it would probably like to. But it is still pretty fast. It's probably going to be able to deal out its own damage. And the hail has now stopped, which means Blizzard is not going to be flawless accuracy anymore. And that is a pity for Arash.
Blizzard Araquanid.
Blizzard Araquanid.
I've never seen it. Never ever. Well, the format is new, but this is a new set as well. Pretty huge. And the Leaf Blade almost taking it out. Are we going to see a freeze, which would help?
I think it would have to be a freeze at this point. We don't get the freeze, and Alejandro's own Araquanid is going to use Leech Life to take game one.
Whoa, what crazy teams from both sides. I really, really love that. I didn't expect Alex to bring Monk and Araquanid to this tournament. Neither did I expect Arash to bring Feromosa and special Araquanid.
Special Araquanid.
That is amazing. That is amazing. The Blizzard probably would have taken out that Kartana. And if he got the freeze, this could have turned the
sadly,
tables around.
Can't rely on that sort of thing. I think he would have had to get the freeze on both of the opposing Pokemon at that point. And that's the sort of luck that you've really got to have your fingers crossed for. But it's one of those interesting things. So we have seen all sorts of really interesting metagame calls. We've seen Magnezone yesterday, there with its magnet pull to deal with Celesteela. We've seen things like Toxic Arcanine floating around. We've had the Toxic on Porygon 2 as well. People making these calls for these potentially more stalling, more bulky.
Make sure to bring a pencil and something,
Definitely,
some paper
yes.
to write on. You want to remember the team your opponent is using. And you want to make some notes, like which Pokemon fainted, which item does he have on Pokemon X or Pokemon ABC. And yeah, it's really hard, especially in a best of three. You want to remember.
You have to remember all that crucial information that you get. Something we talked about yesterday was the fact that in a best of three, game one, even if you lose it, you get so much crucial information. You can get things like which Pokemon are faster than others, what items they might be running.
Yeah.
And then you go into game two, even if you go into it with a loss, you go into it with that advantage and that extra information that you can use. So yes, do bring a notebook, bring a pen and paper. During a VGC match, you are allowed to take notes as you go through the game, but you must always go into the next game with a completely beautiful, clean sheet of paper to make your notes for the next game.
Yeah, we have seen Ashton Cox like rolling all over Lyos in the first match, and then Lyo like really made a game plan out of the information he got from Ashton, and then he turned it around and won game two and three and advanced to the next round. And look at the players. Arash is always kind of calm player, so is Alejandro. And no doubt these are top tier players
we got in
Europe, and I'm really excited how this turns out.
This is some of the cream of the European crop I think we have on stream today.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And we've had just incredible match after incredible match. This has just been, we're being spoiled this weekend. This is wonderful.
This is the Pokemon International Championship, and that's why I really love this tournament. You get so many highlight matches for you guys out there and for us to watch and to commentate on. And I think the players are getting ready, and I'm really looking forward to the teams they are bringing.
Yeah. Oh, we've got the microphone down. They're going into live competition mode. They're just not quite ready to see the teams just yet. But I'm excited that we get to showcase a little more talent. And I think we'll just be bringing round after round of masterclass.
Yeah. We have seen so many familiar names making it to day two. And I already heard that the game might start in a few seconds. And whoa. I'm excited.
You ready?
Kay.
Ready to go into the first game of today?
I am ready.
Cool. So we have the teams for you. We have got on Arash's side, we've got Feromosa.
Whoa.
That's something that's fun to see. We've got Tapu Lele, Araquanid, Alolan Ninetales, Incineroar, and Orangaroo.
And on Pokealex side, we got Araquanid, we got Porygon 2, Tapu Koko, Kartana, Salamence, and Muk. Again, another Muk.
Oh, here we go. So, we've got some very unusual Pokemon here. There's a few that we haven't actually seen on stream yet.
We haven't seen like Ferramosa Tapalele on stream yet, but this is a pretty common combination. Ferramosa is known for dishing out a huge amount of damage and being very, very fast. And Tapalele saves it from getting knocked out by priority moves, though. So this is a pretty common combination. But in general, we haven't seen that often. It got that.
Not seen at all, have we?
No, and it's not of a common Pokemon yet. Though it got the fake out option, it got a pretty unique typing in Dark and Fire. And here we see the opening.
Did I see Love Ball Alolan Ninetales there? Gosh, that's pretty. And that might have been a Love Ball Muk as well. So here we have the leads. We have Alolan Ninetales and a Raquinid on Arash's side. Ninetales, a snow warning going off and setting up the hail. Alejandro leads with his own Araquanid partnered next to Alolan Muk.
And this is a pretty good lead for Alejandro.
The longer games, and maybe Special Araquanid is another of these early metagame calls.
Absolutely, absolutely. But Arash didn't build a stally team.
No.
I didn't expect Araquanid to like really half Blizzard, half that skull, and he's really going pretty offensive with the Ferramosa Tapalele core, which is pretty well known. Then he got this Araquanid Ninetales core, probably covering opposing Trick Rooms as well, because Araquanid is naturally pretty slow. Then he got his Oranguru. We haven't seen doing Oranguru stuff on stream yet.
Oranguru.
It's one of my favorite Pokemon, being able to set up Trick Room and instruct really strong moves. And in general, we haven't seen on stream yet. And then we got Alex's team with another Araquanid. We got Muk, as we have seen from Wolf yesterday, a pretty neat choice, and he explained us why he chose Muk. He got Porygon 2 as well, then Kartana and Salamence. Well, Salamence is a thing Alex likes a lot. He really often brings Salamence to tournaments, and it oftentimes pays out, and I'm really curious if Arash is going to go for the hail mode again, or if he's just trying to pick up some knockouts as fast as possible. As we have seen, Ferramosa is able to learn high jump kick. Maybe being able to take up Porygon 2 in one hit, because we have seen the life orb. And there we see the teams coming up.
We don't seem to have sound this time round, so you guys are going to have to listen to us a little bit more. There we go. There's a little bit of sound. There we go. We get some sound effects. So yes, here we go. We have got Ferramosa and Ninetales, slightly more aggressive lead from Arash's side this time round, and we have Muk and Araquanid once again on Alejandro's side.
Again, this is a pretty aggressive lead from Arash. Ferramosa even learns Blizzard as well, so there may be some Blizzard spam thing from Arash's side, but Araquanid resists Blizzard obviously, and Muk is pretty sturdy and could take out one Pokemon in return if he stands the Blizzard spam.
So obviously we're meant to be commenting on these players' skill, but I also want to comment on their fashion choices. Alejandro, he's got the basic trainer there. He's not done any customization. I really think he could have put in more of an effort into his trainer's appearance for this tournament. Arash, he's the stylish one. He's come in with a stylish pose. He's got his sunglasses on. That's effort. I appreciate that. Important protect there from Ferramosa. Yeah. More back onto important things. Does take a little bit of hail damage, but similar to last game, we see quite a slow, just a board building first turn. Both players just sort of scout each other out a little bit.
Yeah, Arash is playing it pretty safe. He just wants to see what is Alejandro going to target. And then the mind games begin. Then Alejandro has to choose whether he targets again the same Pokemon or not. And now Arash cannot protect anymore. He has to go offensive, and he better wants to take out one Pokemon to not getting knocked out both.
Well, it's almost certain that Ferramosa is going to be able to get off a powerful attack here. As we say, she is the most fast thing in the format with 151 base speed, which is 21 points above the next one down, Tapu Koko and Crobat and friends. So we see Muk going for Protect, Ferramosa using High Jump Kick. Oh, sadly it was the Muk that protected, and Ferramosa takes that recoil damage.
This was absolutely, I for myself didn't expect that Protect from Muk, neither did Arash. He was not expecting it, and whoa, that was a huge, Really huge play. Alejandro takes out the Ferramosa. This is really huge.
And that is such a big deal because Ferramosa is such a presence and such an offensive threat when it's on the field. To have taken it down so neatly with just a tiny bit of hail chip damage, that's huge for Alejandro. It does mean that Arash has got the Aurora Veil up again. But we didn't see that being so critical in the previous game. We'll have to see if it is more important this time round. We've got Araquanid coming out in place of Ferramosa, this special Araquanid. We might see it firing off some blizzards.
I've never seen a blizzard Araquanid before. This is like really a odd and creative choice from Arash. But he doesn't look that happy with his Ferramosa being taken out. Excellent read from Alejandro protecting the buck, not taking any damage at all besides some chip hail damage. And now his Araquanid is also pretty dangerous for the Ninetales. Muk and Araquanid may.
Oh, we see Wyvern from Araquanid here. That is a wonderful tech move to have on it, potentially trying to get past these blizzards that could be coming in. But we see Freeze Dry from Ninetales. That's going to be super effective on the Araquanid. Not quite doing a fair amount of damage, but not a huge amount. Muk, however, is going to do great things with its poison jab, taking Ninetales down to the red HP and getting that poison off again. That's probably not going to take Ninetales down this turn, but it's almost certainly going to reduce Ninetales' longevity greatly. Here we see the Hydro Vortex coming in for a rush. We know now that it's a special Hydro Vortex. Yeah. It depends on the physicality of the base move that is used from. So Hydro Vortex can be physical or special, but this will probably be Scald Hydro Vortex into the Muk slots.
Let's have a look.
Once again, Muk falling to a Hydro Vortex from the Araquanid.
Those water sap moves from Araquanid are so insanely strong.
Water Bubble is a scary ability.
Absolutely. First, you may overread that ability, but once you try out your Araquanid on yourself, you see how powerful those water type attacks are. And a really good read from Arash, not going for any Blizzard at all. He plays Araquanid
himself.
Yeah,
that was so good.
And he knows that there is the potential from White Guard coming, and this was a good read from Arash.
But here we have Tapu Koko has now switched into the field. Tapu Koko now being the fastest thing on the field. We'll have to see if it can deal out some of the damage that it didn't really get to deal out last time.
Yeah, this is a pretty good situation for Alejandro now. He can easily take out Arash's Pokemon. Arash's Araquanid moved after Muk. So it's really, really slow, and it gets its attack off last. And
yeah, that's a good shout from him. He's gone for the Dazzling Gleam, not fearing the opposing Wide Guard from Arash's own Araquanid, and it takes down Ninetales. Ninetales would have gone down at the end of the turn anyway, but this means it's not able to get off its own powerful special attack. We have Leech Life from Alejandro's Araquanid, healing back a little bit of its own health. And
we see Surf!
What is this? This is Surf Araquanid, ladies and gentlemen. And that has done quite pleasant damage. It's not quite enough to take out the Tapu Koko. It's got a couple of turns of hail chip at the very least there now. But that's interesting. Interesting. Absolutely. That Arash didn't fear the Wide Guard this time.
He maybe had to go for Surf to take out both Pokemon. Oh, and there he comes.
Here comes a Rangaroo.
This is going to be interesting. If Arash gets up the Trick Room, and we have seen Araquanid move last, so it's naturally slower than Alejandro's Araquanid. So Arash is trying to get up the Trick Room and to fire off some attacks. He can easily take out Tapu Koko, but he has to think about how to take it out.
This is the thing, because he could go, if he manages to get Trick Room off and get the Surf off with Araquanid, we haven't seen if it has Protect yet, I don't think. He could go for the Surf, and that would he'd be able to take out both of them potentially, but he would have to be very careful of that Wide Guard from Alejandro's Araquanid. So he might be better off single targeting.
Right there, he got that Muk with poison moves. Well.
So Muk can run a couple of different abilities. You never know, we might have Poison Touch, but I think it's more likely that we have the Power of Alchemy ability on these Muks.
Yeah.
on this muck. Araquanid has the water bubble ability, which has that sneaky, secretive extra effect of doubling the power of its water type moves. And as we have seen, Ninetales has Snow Warning. Ninetales coming in with the Protect here, as is Arash's own Araquanid. Now, Arash's Araquanid, if... I don't know, I was going to talk about speed types there, but Alejandro's has not protected. Muk trying to get in the Poison Jab there, and Araquanid going for the Liquidation, double targeting the Ninetales.
Pretty clever to take that Ninetales out as soon as possible. But do not forget that a Glutenine on Muk might be possible as well for some special berries to heal back up a huge amount of health. And still the ball position didn't change at all. Arash now has to switch out his Ninetales, otherwise it gets knocked out. He gets some pretty neat... Well, the only safe switch he could do is Incineroar, which doesn't get taken out, but Araquanid could just use a Water-type move in that slot and...
Yeah, definitely. It would be risky. Incineroar doesn't want to be taking one of those incredibly bulky, powerful water moves from Araquanid, but we have the Aurora Veil going up. Aurora Veil is a new move that can only be used in Hail, but it's effectively light screen and Reflect all in one move.
Yeah.
Here we have the Poison Jab from Muk going into the Ninetales slot. Ninetales just surviving in there. Oh, but it does get the poison. So Ninetales is probably not going to be around for too much longer. Here we have a lovely flowing water type Z move here on Araquanid. We're going to be seeing the Hydro Vortex.
Yeah.
But which one is it going to be targeting into?
I guess the Ninetales. Alejandro wanted to go for a lead as soon as... sorry, guys.
It was Arash's own Araquanid that was using it. Going into that Muk and dealing...
Whoa!
Ooh, incredible damage. And that is Muk taken down. That's impressive. Muk, especially alone Muk, is incredibly bulky.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a huge knockout. Now Arash got Aurora Veil up and just trades Pokemon.
I think that was an okay trade. He's got Hail up.
Absolutely.
He's managed to get his Aurora Veil up. His team is now got that extra little bit of bulk just to help him survive some of the very strong attacks that could be coming in from Alejandro's side.
That waterfall did so much damage.
Oh my goodness! Yes,
but Liquidation probably. But
here come the Alolan Guardians.
In comes Tapu Koko and. Tapu Koko's Electric Surge activates first, and then we see Tapu Lili's Psychic Surge. Now we know that Tapu Koko is faster, and Tapu Lili doesn't wear a Choice Scarf, which is a common item. And Tapu Lili is now able to dish out a huge amount of damage. Arash already got the Aurora Veil up, so his Araquanid probably doesn't go down to a Thunderbolt coming from Tapu Koko, not boosted by Electric Tyran. And this is... Arash is doing really good. He's preparing the board to slowly take out some Pokemon from Alejandro.
And I think Alejandro realized this, going on the defensive a little bit, keeping his Tapu Koko protected. Tapu Lili using Psychic, and it was right to protect the Tapu Koko because he's managed to avoid that. Here we have Scald from Araquanid into the opposing Araquanid, maybe trying to get a burn off there?
Yeah, probably he's fishing for some burn. I've never seen a Scald on Araquanid before. Good choice there.
But here we have Alejandro's own Z move. Also on the Araquanid, we're going to be seeing another Hydro Vortex. And we'll just have to see who it's going to go into. Who are we targeting? Is the Tapu Lele.
And this is going to be really crucial. And...
Oh!
Whoa!
It looks like that Aurora Veil important there, but it's not going to matter.